C'è la seconda parte, diciamo, delle conferenze che avevamo organizzato per questo workshop e il nostro ospite è Martin Reincano dello studio Topo Tecuno di Berlino. Martin Reincano è nato a Buenos Aires, è laureato in storia dell'arte alla Frankfurt University, giusto? È in progettazione del paesaggio alla Technical University of Hannover in Karlsruhe. Ha lavorato nello studio di Peter Walker e Martha Schwarz a San Francisco e ha collaborato con Gabi Kieffer a Berlino. Nel 1996 ha fondato lo studio Topo Tecuno, è uno studio di architettura del paesaggio. Loro hanno vinto moltissimi premi, è diciamo, probabilmente uno dei loro, forse il loro progetto più iconico e anche più, non so se più famoso, ma sicuramente particolarmente iconico, è Spurkilen a Copenaghen.
Anche nuovo, è nuovo.
È nuovo. Ci sono moltissimi progetti, se voi andate sul sito di Topo Tecuno il portfolio è assolutamente ricchissimo. Nello specifico Spurkilen è un progetto che racchiude una delle definizioni più interessanti che io ho trovato di Spurkilen. È stato definito a surrealistic collection of a global urban diversity that reflects the true nature of the local neighborhood rather than perpetuating a petrified image of homogeneous Denmark. Cioè, perché è stato definito una collezione surrealistica della diversità globale urbana che riflette la natura dei quartieri piuttosto che perpetuare una immagine petrificata della Danimarca. Spurkilen è stato costruito in un quartiere multirazziale dove ci sono circa 59 diverse lingue e nazionalità e il loro lavoro, che poi lui adesso ci illustrerà, ha provato a portare tutti questi elementi all'interno di un progetto di spazio pubblico. Quindi niente, io lo ringrazio per essere venuto e per fornirci un riflesso al lavoro anche che stiamo facendo con José e buon lavoro.
Grazie mille per l'introduzione. Il mio italiano è molto basico perché la mia lingua natale è lo spagnolo. Io parlo un po' di italiano per la discussione. È possibile di fare in italiano, ma allora per la presentazione per me è più facile di farlo in inglese. Io aspetto che tutti che sono studenti parli inglese, che è un standard internazionale allora. O no? Chi non parla? Uno. Scusa, scusa. No, è una traduttrice? Un interprete, un'interpretatora di me. So thank you very much for inviting me. And there will be some interruptions because there is a translator going to translate into English. And it was interesting how I arrived in the city. I've never been here before. And it's a good thing to see how, in the end, public interest changes the city. And it's not kind of the sensation that we had for many years, as was Juan was saying today, that kind of politicians would decide the programs of cities, or investors would decide the programs of cities. But in the end, economical bad times that we have are the best times for public interest to influence the development of the city, because the money is not as sportive in these days. So this is the time when the possibilities to influence on developments are bigger than when the money is really hungry to find a place. So, and as we have economical difficult times, and you more than we in the north of Europe, I think it's good that you take the initiative to press your interest into the city. Bueno, dale, dale, dale.
Allora, benvenuti a tutti, grazie per avermi invitato. È un onore per me essere qui. Ci saranno delle interruzioni al mio discorso dovute appunto alla traduzione. Cercheremo di accordarci per cercare di rendere la traduzione più scorrevole possibile. Dunque, è stato molto interessante nel momento in cui sono arrivato in questa città vedere appunto gli elementi importanti di, che sono cambiati nel tempo e soprattutto come sono stati realizzati i cambiamenti per quanto riguarda i centri di interesse pubblico che hanno appunto apportato delle modifiche, delle innovazioni nella città. La politica e gli investimenti hanno un ruolo molto importante per la decisione di questi cambiamenti che vanno appunto a modificare il futuro della città. E come in molti casi i momenti economici come questi sono importanti e sono determinanti per definire dei nuovi, appunto, dei nuovi cambiamenti, cioè bisogna in questo momento approfittare di queste tempistiche, queste modalità economiche per poter apporre appunto questi cambiamenti.
L'importante è l'influenza della gente, che è differente in tempo di molti, come si dice, saldi, non è facile perché l'influenza del saldi è forte, ma allora la situazione economica negativa è buona per uno sviluppo bottom up, per uno sviluppo della gente, okay? Dal basso. So, just to, I learn a little bit of Italian with you. If I think that you don't translate me right, I try to yes. to copy. But however, the title of the lecture I have is a title that I always use. It's this personal public space, because one of the general tendencies and mega trends that we are experiencing now worldwide is a paradigm change of the public and the private. It used to be very clear what was private and what was public. The apartment, your house, the place you would live would be clearly private, and the space outside your house, the sidewalk, the street, the mere public space being parks, squares, etc., would be clearly public. This kind of clarity in typologies changed mainly for one reason, and it has to do with our culture of information, with television, with radio to start with, and then obviously with the internet. So the walls that used to be really protecting us from the public, so to speak, these walls are not holding out the public anymore, because the public, in form of television, in form of internet, invades our private space. And on the other side, as we don't have privacy anymore, because everything that we do in the net also is being seen by someone and collected by someone, it's like living in a village. Everyone would know who is the whore, who is the stupid, who is the bonkers, whatever. So we now live really in a global village. And I don't know if it's good or not, but this is the case. What is interesting, so, is that the use of the public space changed, because we are not fixed to a place for working anymore, because we can take our devices, our work tools with us. We can work now also in public space. So the public space becomes, in that respect, not only less public, in the sense, or let's put it like that, or maybe I go back to, or maybe you translate a little bit before I get too far. Yeah.
Sebbene per le persone i momenti di crisi economica non siano dei momenti facili da gestire, per noi possono essere dei buoni momenti, delle situazioni da cui partire per appunto sviluppare dal basso, per far sì che sia la gente che faccia questi cambiamenti. Il titolo di questa lezione lo utilizzo spesso perché rappresenta una tendenza che si sta verificando, molto importante in tutto il mondo, e che è appunto questa la tendenza che vede il cambiamento, la transizione, il cambiamento appunto della differenza della definizione di spazi privati e pubblici. Un tempo era molto chiaro e distinto che cosa era privato e che cosa era pubblico. Una casa è uno spazio privato, le strade, delle piazze, eccetera, sono dei luoghi pubblici. Questa chiarezza, che appunto un tempo era molto chiara, adesso è cambiata, perché Perché questo? Perché sono subentrati strumenti come gli strumenti di informazione culturale, come le televisioni, la radio e internet, che hanno appunto abbattuto questa differenza. Quei muri che un tempo ci proteggevano, proteggevano il pubblico, adesso non ci sono più. E quindi le televisioni, la televisione invade la nostra vita privata, il nostro spazio privato. Quindi inoltre non abbiamo più la stessa privacy di prima, perché su internet ormai è possibile trovare tutte le informazioni, tutti sappiamo se una cosa è positiva o negativa, perché adesso viviamo in un villaggio globale. Quindi la cosa interessante è proprio il cambiamento che è avvenuto dell'utilità, dell'uso degli spazi pubblici adesso, perché mentre un tempo eravamo fissi in un unico spazio, adesso invece la tecnologia, la modernità ci consente di spostarci, di portare con noi gli strumenti che utilizziamo nelle nostre case in spazi pubblici. Quindi adesso quegli spazi non sono più soltanto appunto pubblici.
So having the public space and because the walls don't protect our privacy, we also can be outside being seen by everyone. So this kind of on the other side, we all know that this idea of privacy is quite a new idea that was developed maybe by the middle classes in the 19th century, because before that everyone would also live in a quite public context where everyone could see what would happen. Even if you would be rich, there would be a lot of servants around you seeing every moment of you, even when you go for a shit or whatever, they would be around you. So some of you understand some English, that's really great. And I think that there is a lot of things to say about it, and we heard a lot of things very critical towards this development. On the other side, it gives a big chance and a big possibilities to rethink the role of the public space. One, that it needs a new typologies of public spaces that can be more privately used, and also public spaces that are not only, let's say, bucolic in the sense of being places to enjoy life or maybe to be recreative, doing sports, but places of production as well. Also, that's nothing new, especially to the Mediterranean culture with your climate, where people would extend their activities towards the street and make the street a transition zone, the sidewalk a transition zone between public and private. So these new developments, I think, are very important to have in mind when I'm going to present to the project that in Copenhagen, and also for the discussion we're having today about this building that is also somehow between history and future, is not really finished, is not completely breaking apart. It has a use, but not a real use. This kind of in-betweenness, I think, is a little bit what our time is about. That is not; it doesn't have the clear clarity, the typological clarity that we might be used to in an urban context.
Dunque, stavamo dicendo appunto che adesso non ci sono più quei muri che ci proteggevano prima, è cambiato il nostro concetto di privacy, adesso siamo visibili da tutti quanti. Inoltre, sono cambiate le cose rispetto agli inizi del Novecento, quando eravamo comunque circondati, anche le persone più ricche erano circondate magari da servi che entravano nella loro privacy. Adesso invece non è la stessa cosa. Quindi ci sono tante cose molto importanti che ci possono far spingere verso un nuovo sviluppo. E questa rappresenta una grande possibilità, una grande sfida, proprio quella cambiare, di dare un nuovo ruolo agli spazi pubblici. In che senso? Nel senso, in un duplice senso, da un punto di vista è possibile, dobbiamo cercare di renderli più privati e dobbiamo anche cercare di renderli più bucolici, nel senso che devono diventare dei posti in cui si possono svolgere attività ricreative, attività divertenti, ma anche attività in cui viene prodotta qualcosa. Noi siamo nel Mediterraneo, anche in questa zona appunto abbiamo assistito a questa grande transizione tra pubblico e privato, questo cambiamento di definizione e questo nuovo sviluppo è molto importante ed è stato appunto anche alla base del progetto svolto da me a Copenaghen. Adesso l'edificio che abbiamo visto oggi, ad esempio, rappresenta un edificio che non è ancora terminato, è come se sia intrappolato tra il passato e il futuro e dobbiamo appunto vedere che cosa, come poter andare avanti e cambiare le cose.
So, just to add, I am a landscape architect, that's what I studied. So I'm not an architect that turned into landscape architect. I studied just landscape architecture and a little bit of art history. That's important to say. So I know that you are all all architects. I am going to give you a little introduction to my profession, to landscape architecture and its origins, because they're important strategically later for the project I'm going to present to you.
Non so se sapete che ho studiato storia dell'arte e sono specialista in architettura del paesaggio, quindi vorrei darvi diciamo, una piccola spiegazione appunto da un punto di vista di architettura del paesaggio che poi sarà molto importante per capire quello che sarà spiegato dopo.
Ok, to start with, it's important to know that the origin of our profession is actually paradise, this perfect place, and almost the origin of it's a disco light show. I'm supposed to dance? I thought that came later. Okay. So the very origin again of our profession, like the first cell, so to speak, of the profession, is Paradise Garden. And Paradise Garden is in the end a dream that exists in every society. It's this dream of this perfect place. It's the dream of the uterus of your mother. That it was so perfect that you even don't remember it. You never suffer hunger. It was never too cold, never too warm, never anything that made you in any way unhappy. And this is the dream. We all want to go back to mama, the Italian guys more than other ones, obviously. And they actually do it. That's a big difference. But in the end, this idea of returning to this perfection, this idea of the perfect place that is natural but not wild and dangerous, that is that in which weather plays a role, but again, it's civilized, and even sexuality is not a force like in real life, but something that has the mellowness and the perfection, like in childhood. So this is the origin of our profession, and also this origin has a very religious connotation, because obviously the first landscape architect who did this garden was God, and the Pope is from Argentina, so there is some kind of relationship there too. But what is important that in difference to architecture started in the end as a bare necessity. Gardens started as a dream. So this is a very, 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 there are a lot of things that we have in common, architects and landscape architects, but this function towards dream, I think is a big difference. I can make the film again, so it's...
Quindi è molto importante immaginare qual è, pensare a qual è l'origine della nostra professione. Può essere, possiamo appunto parlare dell'Eden, del paradiso terrestre. Perché? La nostra, diciamo, l'origine della nostra professione, le cellule primordiali possono essere appunto paragonate al paradiso terrestre proprio perché rappresentava un posto perfetto, era un sogno, un po' come del quale non ricordiamo più nulla, un po' come non ricordiamo più di quei momenti stupendi, perfetti, passati nel ventre delle nostre mamme. Alla fine, però... Quello che vogliamo, appunto, la cosa alla quale aspiriamo è proprio ritornare a questa perfezione, la perfezione della natura che però non era selvaggia. Inoltre, l'origine della nostra professione è anche qualcosa di, che ha una certa connotazione religiosa, perché se noi pensiamo al primo architetto paesaggistico, appunto lo possiamo identificare con Dio o per l'Argentina con il Papa. Quindi è molto importante cercare appunto di pensare a questa idea del sogno, a questo passaggio. Ed è proprio in questo che l'architettura è importante.
Okay. So, in the end, that's a reason we as landscape architects, as gardeners, are also used to a certain tension. Because as we know that we are not God, but we try to play God, and we are never going to fulfill and to be as fast. I mean, he did the whole world in 6 days and had one day to rest. So, and that's the reason we accept to a certain extent that we have to constantly work against a force that is in the end nature, and to create our own dreams is something that can't be fulfilled. And I think that's also a big difference to architecture, that always had the fantasies that it could change the world forever and in a very, very stable way. And so one of the strategies, okay, maybe you should translate that. It's going to take ages.
No,
yeah. No, don't worry. Yeah.
Quindi dicevamo, parlavamo di Dio che era la perfezione. Il nostro problema è che per quanto ci possiamo sforzare, noi non siamo Dio, non possiamo raggiungere quel mondo perfetto. Perché dobbiamo sempre lavorare andando a contrastare una forza che è sempre presente, che è appunto la natura. Per creare quindi quel sogno di mondo perfetto dobbiamo lavorare molto, ma l'architettura in questo invece ci può essere molto utile, perché può cambiare il mondo in maniera molto stabile e molto efficace.
It's the other way around, actually.
No, sorry. May I ask? If you do this kind of length, I can do it without notes. Just tell me.
Okay. Well, the point is actually the other way around. We landscape architects are rather used to not being able to fulfill something, because nature is always more forceful. God is always better than we are. Okay. Mm-hmm. The architects, in opposition, have at least the feeling that they can do things in a very stable. So we are used to this kind of flow of things that are. It's important to have the fantasy of trying to go back to mama, but it's not going to work. Okay.
Diciamo che noi uomini, ovviamente, per quanto ci possiamo sforzare, abbiamo sempre dei limiti, non potremo mai raggiungere la perfezione del lavoro fatto da Dio. Però l'architetto che cosa ha? Ha quella sensazione, quel sentimento che pensa di poter riuscire ad arrivare a realizzare qualcosa di quasi perfetto. È quella la differenza.
So, I just say that because I think it's also in the context of the project we looked at today, that sometimes maybe the difference between gardening or doing architecture is gardening has to do with cultivating, with trying to get things on a long run to a form, rather than getting things instantly to a form.
Un'altra differenza è che che cosa succede? Noi, invece di pensare a realizzare delle cose in maniera istantanea, realizziamo delle cose che devono durare nel tempo, che hanno appunto lunga durata, e questa è la differenza. Devono essere, sì, coltivate nel tempo.
Okay, so I think that's important. The key word is it's cultivation, because it always means that you have to kind of do it forever. It's not something that you ever finish. You know, a garden is something that you actually, in the end, never finish. And we can think of the city in the same way. We could think of the city as an organism that you constantly have to cultivate. And then I think if we would have just this attitude, it would change the way we would approach the city in general.
Quindi è molto importante appunto soffermarsi su avere questa attitudine, questo approccio del coltivare, cioè ci fa capire appunto l'idea che non deve essere una cosa che è finita, che è realizzata in un solo momento, ma viene realizzata e deve essere continuata, coltivata nel tempo, proprio come facciamo con un giardino. La stessa cosa deve essere riprodotta, rifatta per le città, nelle città.
Okay. So as and then we have different over the hundreds of years that my profession exists, we have developed different strategies to try to create these fantasy worlds that in the end are always tilt, because you know a building is always clearly man-made. A garden is always something that is half God-made and half man-made, you know? And this kind of half nature, half man-made is something we have been working with in different ways. More artificial, sometimes a little bit less. And we have been working a lot with scales. So we want, in a garden, you want to feel different. So for example, if you do things very small, like in a Japanese garden, you feel like God over the big, over your landscape. Or if you do things bigger than you, then you feel like a child because things are out of scale. So this out of scale situation of gardens is very important to transport you to another world, because gardens are in the end always another world, something different to the rest.
Quindi la cosa importante è che quando pensiamo a dei giardini pensiamo ad una cosa dove comunque è stato realizzato da Dio, quindi c'è la mano di Dio, mentre a differenza di quello che realizziamo noi con le nostre mani, quindi questa è una sostanziale differenza. Un'altra cosa importante da tenere in considerazione è la scala, che diciamo la dimensione con la quale ci rapportiamo. Ad esempio, se pensiamo ad un giardino zen dove tutto ha una scala ridotta, ci sentiamo diciamo molto inferiori, ci sentiamo più piccoli rispetto appunto alla dimensione stessa della cosa.
No, we feel big. Scusate, al contrario.
In un giardino zen ci sentiamo, dove tutto è più piccolo, noi ci sentiamo più grandi.
So, or like here in Alice in Wonderland, where everything is kind of out of scale. This kind of out of scale, if smaller or bigger, doesn't matter, is one of the things we work with. Okay.
Proprio come in Alice nel Paese delle Meraviglie, dove dobbiamo appunto approcciarci con delle cose che sono molto più grandi di noi, delle cose che sono molto più piccole di noi.
Okay. So the next thing, and I'm going to do a big jump now, garden history wise. The one thing that is etymologically essential for the garden is its origin. Garden. It's a Germanic word and comes from guard. It comes from to protect something, to do a wall. Il giardino concluso. So it's the idea that a garden always only works as a garden if it has a wall around it. And also paradisos, that comes from Persian, from Farsi, means a walled space. And this is important in the context of the Romantic garden, that I jumped over the Renaissance, the Baroque and everything, because I think that the Romantic garden till our days has had a very, very important influence. And it has been copied, well, maybe you explain that first thing.
Possiamo pensare all'etimologia della parola sia giardino della parola paradiso. La parola giardino deriva da un termine giapponese che vuol dire una zona, diciamo, circondata da delle mura, quindi una cosa racchiusa. Allo stesso modo anche la parola paradiso, che deriva dal farsi, ha la stessa idea di uno spazio incluso. Quindi noi pensiamo al giardino come ad una cosa racchiusa appunto da delle mura. Yes. E questa cosa ci fa ripensare, vi faccio un esempio, passo direttamente al romanticismo, ai giardini del periodo del romanticismo, perché?
Okay, so the garden comes from English, from Germanic, from German, to guard,
ah, okay.
Not from Japanese, from German. Germanic language,
sì,
so
scusate,
it means
guard.
To...
to guard vuol dire appunto custodire, deriva diciamo dalla lingua tedesca, sì.
Okay, so the Romantic garden is for me interesting for different things. One has to understand that the Romantic gardens have been copied so much that we feel them almost kitsch, and maybe they got emblematic. When we think of a park, we think exactly of that kind of picture, a lawn with some trees, and maybe some sculptures, some bridges or whatever. This kind of image got so strong that's almost archetypical for the garden. I'm not interested in that so much, because I actually hate that, and I think that's really kitsch. But strategically, I think it's a very interesting garden, because it has, let's say, three elements that are essential and that might be used for the first time in an artistic object. One of them, and it has also a very radical moment, that is that the English landscape garden got rid of the wall. The English gardens don't have a wall. So you have to imagine that the radicality of these gardens is like if in architecture, if you architects would be able to get rid of your walls. So these guys got rid, or of your roof, they got rid of the essence of the gardens that used to be the wall. They said, we don't need them anymore. Okay? So in that respect, these gardens also play with the flow of things in, rather than having the clean typology. So this is reason number one.
Okay. Quindi, pensando ai giardini dell'epoca romantica, per quanto possano essere da un certo punto di vista considerati kitsch da me, perché diciamo per le loro caratteristiche, sono molto interessanti dal punto di vista strategico per tre motivi. Il primo dei quali è che non ci sono più i muri, si sono andati ad abbattere, diciamo, i confini del, sì, in questo senso i confini del giardino stesso, e che era poi appunto l'essenza di come era fatto invece il giardino inizialmente. Adesso invece ci troviamo davanti ad un flusso di cose, quindi senza più confini.
And that's really it has an incredibly radicality to for that, okay? The next thing that I think is really essential is the issue that the whole garden is about dynamism and about movement. So you have to imagine that gardens till this age was about more framing situations. So framing the state, like in France, you know, framing festivities. It wasn't about movement, okay? In these gardens actually work a little bit like a predecessor of the film. You walk from one picture to the next, okay? That's also one of the reasons this style is called the picturesque, the picture garden, okay? So that in the end, moving through the space, experiencing space in movement, in motion, is essential. And I would say it's the first art object that only works with movement that was ever developed. Because till then, the objects, the buildings, and the cities, everything, was meant to work statically, actually, and not in sequences. So this garden works really in sequences. You have to think, if you think of architecture, maybe that only happened when Frank Lloyd Wright did the museum in New York, where movement is part of the building suddenly, okay? Till then, buildings used to be quite stiff. So, and these guys did it like 200 years before. So we had our Bauhaus 200 years before your architects had it. Just that you know.
La seconda motivazione di questo è che i giardini adesso sono dei giardini dinamici, diventano dei giardini appunto che spingono, che fanno pensare al movimento, perché fino a quell'epoca invece il giardino era stato considerato come l'ideale, diciamo, per situazioni particolari, era circoscritto a situazioni particolari, e invece adesso il giardino assume un nuovo ruolo e diventa un po' il precursore di quello che poi è stato per esempio il film, quindi una sequenza di immagini. Allo stesso modo possiamo pensare appunto al giardino come al passaggio, alla sequenza, allo spostamento da un'immagine all'altra, ed è per questo che si parla di pittoresco, dall'inglese appunto picture, che è immagine. Quindi abbiamo questa idea nuova di movimento, mentre fino a quell'epoca tutto funzionava in modo statico, tutta la città, non soltanto a livello di giardini, a differenza appunto della nuova idea di giardini, che è un'idea dinamica. E se pensiamo invece a quello che è successo a New York, beh, lì sono stati, diciamo, un po' più svelti, ci sono arrivati 200 anni prima questa idea di giardino più dinamico.
Di spazio dinamico, un spazio che funziona in movimento, è come un predecessore di film. Okay? This kind of experience now we have when we go to the movies. The only difference is that these movies actually where you had to participate and you not were only just getting them, and they were really three-dimensional, and they also smelled, and they, you know, they had real weather, so it was even more of a fake in the end. It was a much more sophisticated fake, if you think of it, than maybe a movie, because you never knew exactly if it was real reality or fake reality. So it was somewhere in between, because you had real weather and somehow real trees, but maybe not real trees from the place where they were from. Okay. So in this kind of being lost in time and space, I think it makes this strategy of these gardens so incredibly actual and modern.
Quindi la differenza invece, la differenza con il film con il quale abbiamo appunto fatto questa metafora è che noi nel giardino partecipiamo e siamo appunto coinvolti e il giardino appunto diventa un'esperienza tridimensionale, una sostanza, una dimensione tridimensionale. Noi odoriamo, sentiamo appunto dei profumi del giardino, ci camminiamo. Quindi è un concetto molto più sofisticato, è una realizzazione, una copia più sofisticata rispetto alla rappresentazione che vediamo in un film, perché per quanto possano essere, perché nel giardino magari vediamo sì degli alberi, però non sappiamo magari se quegli alberi erano già lì, sono stati portati da un altro posto, quindi... È una cosa, il giardino diventa un concetto molto dinamico, ben distinto appunto da quello che era prima.
So, and what is also interesting about this garden time and this style is that the origin of the gardens were actually pictures. So the picture was first and the reality was after. There were two French painters, Claude Lorrain and Nicolas Poussin, and these two guys developed these ideas, these ideal landscapes. And these ideal landscapes were landscapes without borders. It was very open. It was incredibly eclectic. It was a mix of objects, a little bit of nature, a little bit of ocean, situations that never existed like that. It were mere collages. And the English lords, the people with money that made their money mainly with slavery, by the way, they saw these pictures and like clients today said, they went to Capability Brown, that was a famous landscape architect of those days, they said, I want a garden like that in my house. Yeah? Oops, sorry. So they were not as aggressive, maybe. So,
okay.
I think so. Good. So, and this is also interesting because the origin of things nowadays it's the clarity of the origin of things is also not as clear as it used to be. Because normally the origin reality is normally the origin. Okay? So and the representation of the reality is what comes second. So here we have a representation before the actual reality. So we have a complete change of the rhythm how things would be done before. So the abstraction comes before the reality, or the copy comes before the real thing. Okay? So we move backwards, or we from back to... And that is something that we are very used to nowadays, that something that happens in the net or somewhere else comes first before it becomes reality. And that maybe for the project of the crowdfunding, that's very important. You have to create an image that then creates reality and changes reality. That is very normal nowadays. In those days, these things were quite new. So, you see, this is this situation is from Rome. You might recognize it. It's the Angel Palace of the Popes, and they mixed whatever they thought would be interesting. Also, creating this kind of Elysic situation with woman, man, sheep. People, also shepherds, where everyone would be naked and everything would be nice. It is a bit of a new interpretation of the paradise, but in a different way. So.
Quindi, se pensiamo appunto all'origine dei giardini, erano dei quadri, erano dei dipinti. Quindi che cosa è successo? È successo che si è passati da delle cose dipinte alla realtà, perché appunto questi inizialmente i giardini sono stati visti, sono stati inseriti in dei dipinti da pittori francesi che hanno appunto ideato questi giardini senza confini, insieme ad una serie di elementi, erano diciamo molto eclettici come dipinti. Che è successo? Che le persone ricche hanno iniziato a vedere questi dipinti, hanno gradito questa tipologia di giardino e hanno voluto realizzare questi giardini nelle loro case. Quindi abbiamo appunto avuto un passaggio da una rappresentazione che era soltanto astratta ad una cosa reale, mentre oggi in realtà succede il contrario. Noi qui invece abbiamo appunto un'astrazione, una copia che viene da una cosa reale, e questo è quello che avviene oggi, tutti i giorni, anche nelle reti, diciamo online. Noi vediamo qualcosa che si presenta prima che sia stata realizzata nella realtà, e questo elemento deve essere molto importante, il fatto di riuscire ad immaginare una cosa che ancora non esiste, non è reale, può essere molto importante per i nostri progetti.
Esatto.
È un po'...
No, it's the other way around, that the copy was before the original, that's the special thing.
Sì,
the picture was first and then was the original.
Sì.
Did you say that? Okay.
Cioè, la copia... a partire dalla cosa realizzata in copia si è realizzata la cosa reale, quindi la copia, l'astrazione veniva prima della cosa reale che veniva appunto realizzata. Come possiamo vedere in questo dipinto rappresenta un'idea di paradiso in un modo diverso, un nuovo modo appunto di presentare il paradiso, dove comunque vediamo una serie di uomini e donne nude, ci sono degli animali, diciamo è una ricreazione, una rivisitazione in una chiave diversa appunto dell'idea del paradiso.
So coming back to the idea of the picture as the origin of these gardens, you have to imagine that also out of a two-dimensional structure, they develop a three-dimensional space. And to experience this space, they had an object called Claude glass, after Claude Laurent, after one of these painters that I showed you before. And the Claude glass was a mirror that had a frame. And this mirror you would use to frame certain beautiful situations, to get actually the real picture into the real copy again. Okay, so rewind kind of thing, but to have the frame and to make the real picture being because you need the frame to create a picture. And I would say that kind of experience, not only that you would sit down and look at a very beautiful situation, you would make your own pictures, yeah, like we do with this guy, yeah, but you also would use this to experience space in a new way. Walking with these mirrors, you would have a future in front of you, in the past in the back of you, in the presence where you would be standing. So you would have this idea of space, movement, continuum, something that we're very used to, maybe for the first time in history. And I would say, continuing that again, in the end is about manipulating reality, creating reality. And I would say these gardens really recreate in a very extreme way reality without clearly showing that they were faking, in difference to the Baroque, yeah? And to enforce these kind of feelings, they would use these kind of guys, these kind of mirrors, as we use these kind of guys with Google Earth and whatever, to create our own reality that not necessarily has to do with the real reality around us. Perfect timing.
Per tornare appunto all'idea dell'immagine che è all'origine di questo giardino, si è passati da una dimensione, diciamo da un'area bidimensionale ad uno spazio tridimensionale. E per fare questo cosa facevano? Utilizzavano uno strumento chiamato appunto lente a freddo, quindi c'era uno specchio con una cornice che riusciva ad ottenere, si riusciva a prendere quindi l'immagine reale, e però questa veniva appunto inquadrata in questa cornice, era riuscire in questo modo ad avere una nuova percezione, una nuova esperienza di quello che si vedeva intorno, dell'ambiente, di quello che si appunto aveva intorno. Era in questo modo una nuova idea di concepire lo spazio nel movimento che è appunto avvenuta per la prima volta nella storia in questo modo, utilizzando questo strumento. Era un modo per manipolare la realtà, per creare la realtà attraverso questo strumento. Usavano in questo modo quei giardini, andavano appunto a, a creare, a manipolare la realtà, però non si riusciva ad avere la percezione di dove effettivamente c'era stato questo cambiamento, in che cosa erano la copia, e appunto lo realizzavano attraverso strumenti come quello di cui che abbiamo menzionato.
So this idea of experiencing space in movement, for us it's the usual. Since we have planes and cars, and we also have mirrors in the cars, so we recreate even this kind of experience. In America, they also have subtitles because there are, that's a lot about security. So, but in the end, I think that what is interesting maybe to take in account is that this kind, the aesthetic of movement and creating spaces, faking spaces in a natural way, was developed a long time ago, and could be useful for the future. And speaking of the picture, and that's also essential for the group with the crowdfunding, the picture creates a desire. The Rocky Mountains, no one knew anything about the Rocky Mountains before Adams took these beautiful pictures of the Rocky Mountains. So creating desire has a lot to do with capitalism, because you want to buy things if desire is created by you, but also a lot of with identity of places. Places have to a certain extent, create desire to be loved and to be wanted or to be further developed. So there is an interaction, and we are more and more used to this interaction between the image of things and the reality of things. And in many times, by the way, the reality and the picture even don't go together. So gay couples love to go to Montana not for the landscape, that by the way is fake. The mountains in the back don't exist actually in the movie, but to recreate an experience or that they saw in a movie, or even they go to New Zealand, not to see New Zealand, but to see the Lord of the Rings. Okay, so in the end, it's not about a reality, a real reality, but a reality that has been created, and people want to recreate it, but it doesn't exist. So they need a lot of imagination, and they need this image to recreate that. There is one story I would like to tell you. I was teaching in Philadelphia, in America, and you might remember that because it's a half-Italian actor, Rocky, Sylvester Stallone. And he, you remember Rocky, he's from here? No. Okay, now the stairs. He walked always up and down the stairs. You know, they have this huge, but I don't think that I have it in this presentation. Do I have it in this presentation? No, sorry, because I did one where I had it. But they, there is this big stairs in front of this museum, and Rocky was walking, and this is famous music. He was like jumping and having his like towel around his neck, you know, and up and down, whatever. And then, so people, when the Americans, when they think of Philadelphia and they think of this place, they think of Rocky. So what happened is that there is a statue of Rocky in bronze next to the stairs. So someone that never existed becomes an idea of, we are remembering someone that never existed, actually. So we are creating a kind of faked reality. So something that was abstract, like in the landscape garden, something that was a picture, becomes real. Someone that never existed is, and people go and worship this kind of thing. Yeah. So this kind of idea of the picture, the identity that happens actually before reality, is something that for our time got quite usual and normal almost. And we are lost between these different realities now.
Questa idea appunto di sperimentare, di esperienza del movimento nello spazio è una cosa che ci risulta, diciamo, molto comune. Per esempio negli Stati Uniti adesso utilizzano anche, inseriscono ad esempio dei sottotitoli a delle immagini. È quindi interessante riuscire a capire come come rendere questi movimenti e come questi potrebbero essere utili per il futuro. Quindi, se torniamo all'idea appunto dell'immagine, l'immagine che sta alla base crea un desiderio. In questo caso questa cosa ha a che fare molto con il capitalismo, per esempio, perché da quell'immagine abbiamo poi creato un desiderio di una cosa che poi vogliamo a tutti i costi, vogliamo comprare. E ha anche a che fare con una questione appunto di identità dei, dei posti. I posti che vediamo nelle immagini e li desideriamo, vogliamo appunto realizzarli, quindi andiamo a creare nuovi posti che abbiamo visto soltanto in immagine. Quindi c'è questa forte interazione tra immagini e cose reali. A volte questa interazione, queste due cose, immagine e cose reali, non corrispondono, non, ci sono delle diversità. Per esempio, nell'immagine che ho fatto vedere prima di Montana, che era stato appunto sovrapposto, inserito nell'immagine, non era stato veramente lì in quel luogo. Quindi, che cosa succede? Che riusciamo a ricreare delle realtà, che a vedere delle... a ricreare appunto delle realtà che non esistono a partire dalle immagini. Per esempio, quando pensiamo all'immagine di... cioè, mi sono recato a Filadelfia e ho visto che hanno installato una statua di Sylvester Stallone perché tutti hanno associato quel posto a quello che hanno visto nel film di Rocky, dove lui saliva su quella scala, andava su e giù con l'asciugamano, con la musica nelle orecchie. Quindi, a partire da quell'immagine che è stata vista, hanno creato appunto una cosa che prima non c'era, adesso addirittura c'è una statua. Quindi è una cosa che appunto un tempo era soltanto un'immagine, adesso è diventata una cosa realmente esistente.
Okay. The point is in the end that we as planners, as architects, landscape architects, we can't only anymore just manipulate the object as we were used to, but nowadays we have to start to think of the pre-object and the post-object. Things have a pre-life and an afterlife. So this crowdfunding, this social engagement becomes as much part of architecture as these pictures become part of the reality of places that then happen afterwards. So we have to openly manipulate these processes and make them part, not in all projects, but in many projects, and make these communicative processes part of our projects.
Quindi, una cosa che dobbiamo pensare in quanto architetti è che non dobbiamo soltanto manipolare l'oggetto, ma dobbiamo anche avere chiaro, pensare alla vita prima di quell'oggetto e alla vita dopo quell'oggetto, quindi al pre, al post di quell'oggetto, pensando anche a quello che può essere la sua implicazione, il suo coinvolgimento sociale, a livello sociale. Quindi dobbiamo andare a manipolare questo processo comunicativo non solo, cioè in tutti i nostri progetti in quanto architetti.
So I'm going to do a bit of a jump now because otherwise okay. So the project, now I'm going to show you the project that we did in Copenhagen. It was opened two summers ago, so it's 2 years old. And I was saying, and obviously it's the most famous project we did, and it's the youngest project. So it's like with children, the youngest project gets like the most attention till it gets older and new projects come along. So, but I think that this, even being young, I think is quite an essential project. And the motivation for this project, to tell you the story behind the project, to start with, the situation from which it started, is a neighborhood called Nørrebro in the north of Copenhagen. And in this neighborhood, we have like 60 different nationalities, very, very few Danish people living there, a kind of a ghetto situation. Yeah. And we have a political... Maybe you explain that.
E adesso vorrei fare un salto, parlarvi di un progetto che ho realizzato appunto a Copenaghen due stati fa, ed è il progetto forse il più famoso di tutti. Adesso invece è stato uno dei primi progetti e adesso ne stanno realizzando, stanno pensando ad un nuovo progetto. Perché vi voglio parlare di questo esempio? Perché vi voglio illustrare appunto la situazione di partenza. Il quartiere in cui è stato realizzato questo progetto era un quartiere con diverse etnie, era considerato proprio un ghetto.
A lot of social problems. The context, the political context of Copenhagen and of Denmark, let's say when the whole process started by the people, was a very right-wing movement of the whole country, from being very liberal to becoming quite a xenophobic place.
Quindi un'altra cosa importante per quanto riguarda il contesto di questo progetto è il problema sociale, il contesto politico, la situazione politica nella quale appunto viveva Copenaghen nella Danimarca in quel periodo, cioè si stava passando da essere un paese molto liberale ad essere molto tendente alla xenofobia.
Okay. And in the same time, we had not only in Denmark, but all over Europe, we have tendencies of xenophobic situations. In France, for example, the burqa was forbidden. You know this beautiful dress, where you just see the eyes? I would like to have one of those, actually. No, don't worry.
Un po' in tutta l'Europa si assisteva a questa tendenza verso la tendenza xenofoba, per esempio durante quegli anni in Francia è stato vietato l'utilizzo del burqa.
And in Switzerland minarets were forbidden, for example. It's not allowed to build a minaret in Switzerland. Yeah? So actually quite radical decisions.
E per esempio anche in Svizzera adesso non possono essere più costruiti minareti.
So,
quindi sono delle decisioni abbastanza radicali che sono state prese.
I mean, so we have a European development in different countries, different developments. The whole picture is that immigration becomes more and more a social issue, okay? Because it was never started like in the Americas, as an idea of the state that would depend and be developed out of immigration of different cultures, but happened more or less accidentally because we were rich, some people were coming and we took some refugees, but there was no concept around immigration.
Quindi che in quel periodo questo era quello che stava avvenendo un po' in vari paesi in Europa l'immigrazione iniziava a divenire una questione sociale, perché non si aveva appunto l'idea di uno stato preciso, ma si creavano per caso situazioni in cui si vedeva da un lato i rifugiati, da un lato i ricchi, quindi non c'era quel concetto di integrità di Stato per quanto riguarda appunto la questione dell'immigrazione.
So what we see is a very repressive attitude towards immigrants, and this repression we know because we could see also European history as a history of emancipation. You know, we had the proletarian emancipation, we had the Jews were emancipated, we had the woman emancipating, now we have the children emancipating, so it's all, the man didn't emancipate yet, so we're working on that. But everyone, every social group has been emancipating, and I think that we are on a point where we found out that immigration is a key issue for our societies, because our societies are getting older and older, and we need this kind of fresh blood, let's say, to enrich our societies, because otherwise we are not going to be able to maintain the wealth. Germany, by the way, last year had 1 million immigrants, legal immigrants, 1 million, mainly from Europe, mainly from Italy and Spain, And it's the same amount of immigrants like the United States. So immigration is not anymore something that happens accidentally, but a very, very important issue. Nowadays in Germany we have around 25% of the population have at least one foreign father or mother. So it's 25% of a country of 80 million people. So it's not a little group, you know. It's smaller than women. Women are more. Children are also more. But the question is now how to deal with immigration, because emancipation, there are two velocities for emancipation. One that goes towards revolution and one that is more revolutionary. Okay? So if we don't want social disturbances like we had them in Paris, in the banlieues, or in London recently, if we don't want this kind of situations, we have to allow much more and allow, or let's say, give more space to the emancipation of foreigners. Evolution.
Evolution.
So one is really like disturbance, turning on wheels, I mean to burn wheels and kill people in the very extreme, the Russian Revolution. And the other way is like this kind of process of changing, allowing to change your position in society. Because in the end, what we see is just an oppression of a small minority. Why should a church have a tower and a minaret and a mosque don't have a tower? Or why should a woman walk with a mini skirt, where you can see the slippers, and a woman can't walk like that? I mean, who cares? Or why can a priest walk in a dress, you know? Is he gay? What is his problem, you know? So, and why can't, what kind of these people? So in the end, I think that there is a very classical oppressive politics towards these migrants. And in the end, I mean, one could say Europe don't need them, but this is not the case. Especially the Nordic, the Northern European countries that are economically very strong need migration heavily. But you can't have the people without their soul, you know? You can't have them just as working force. Obviously, they bring their dramas and their things. So, and the concept of this project that I'm talking about deals with the issue how, or let's say like that, this was a competition. This competition was done, we did it together with BIC and Superflex. It's an architectural office in Copenhagen and an artist group in Copenhagen. We were invited, the three of us, and we won that competition. The program for this competition was actually, for this very bad neighborhood, how can a public space change the situation of the migrants in this neighborhood? That wasn't our idea, that was the program. So we just tried to have a concept to answer this program. The pre-picture was done before. That was a political situation. And one important connotation is that half the money for this project was, half the financiation for this project was a Danish foundation called Realdania, a very unique thing. They have a lot of money, and they use the money to make the public space better. Okay, so they finance schools, kindergartens, squares, etc. So it was also not public money. It was someone, a foundation, that said, there is a problem, we have to face that. If we don't do something with our foreigners in this neighborhood, we are going to have situations like in France. So, yeah, I hate this translation thing. You have to learn English when I come next time, please. Or I have to learn Italian. Otherwise, you fall all asleep, and me too. That would be bad, actually. I never felt asleep in a lecture. That shouldn't happen now. So, so the idea was,
sorry.
No, yeah, go ahead.
Quindi, che cosa abbiamo visto succedere? Abbiamo visto una serie di atti repressivi contro questi migranti. Nella nostra storia abbiamo visto molti casi di emancipazione, l'emancipazione dei proletari, degli ebrei, delle donne, vedremo l'emancipazione adesso dei bambini. Quindi tutti i gruppi sociali sono stati emancipati. Per cui che cosa dobbiamo appunto pensare adesso? Che gli immigrati devono essere importanti, devono essere la chiave per la nostra società, perché in un certo senso la nostra società, che comunque diventa sempre più vecchia, ha bisogno di, tra virgolette, quella, diciamo, carne fresca, diciamo, gente giovane che può essere appunto utile per la nostra società, per mantenere la ricchezza delle nostre società. Pensiamo ad esempio al dato della Russia, in cui ci sono circa 1 milione di immigrati, che è più o meno lo stesso totale di immigrati presenti negli Stati Uniti. Quindi la cosa importante è che adesso gli immigrati, cioè l'immigrazione non è una cosa che avviene per caso, ma è una cosa che è importante e deve essere, diciamo, pensata e sfruttata al meglio. Non perché gli immigrati adesso non rappresentano più un piccolo gruppo, ma dobbiamo, appunto per questo dobbiamo capire come gestire, cosa fare con questi immigrati, perché diciamo che ci sono alcuni, diciamo, ci sono due livelli di evoluzione. Da un certo lato ci sono quelli che spingono all'evoluzione, da un certo lato ci sono quelli che spingono appunto alla rivoluzione. E se non vogliamo trovarci in situazioni appunto di disturbi, di rivoluzione, dobbiamo consentire, dobbiamo dare più opportunità agli immigrati, dare più spazio agli immigrati e alla loro emancipazione. E questa è la cosa importante, perché appunto in tutti i paesi economicamente forti abbiamo bisogno degli immigrati, che non devono essere considerati soltanto come dei lavoratori, ma hanno comunque la loro storia, hanno i loro drammi. Dobbiamo quindi cercare di vederli nel loro insieme. Ecco perché nel mio progetto a Copenaghen, al quale appunto siamo stati invitati per partecipare a questa gara, a questa competizione, ci hanno detto che il programma era quello riuscire a trovare delle modalità per poter cambiare lo spazio pubblico in maniera da, cioè pensando appunto anche agli immigrati. E noi abbiamo cercato di dare una risposta a quel programma. Una cosa molto interessante è che metà dei finanziamenti di quel progetto sono arrivati dalla Fondazione Verdania, che utilizzava il denaro per finanziare il miglioramento di spazi pubblici, che potevano essere scuole, parchi, eccetera. Quindi l'attitudine è quella di riconoscere un problema e fare qualcosa per cambiare la situazione.
Perfetto. So the project has maybe three columns. One is the political situation that we talked about of migration. Strategically we said it has, like, the approach has maybe two. And one is the idea that parks, to a certain extent, always been migrated spaces. You always wanted to have the Greek temple in England. You always wanted to have the Mediterranean garden in Northern Europe, etc. So there's always this idea, this Arabic garden in other places. So the paradise is this place that is not your place. So it's something that traveled, like migrants did, and that uses objects from different places, trees from different places.
Quindi ci sono, diciamo, tre colonne portanti di questo progetto. Una è stata appunto la situazione politica degli immigrati in quel momento, in quel paese. L'altra cosa era riuscire a capire dal punto di vista strategico come ideare l'idea appunto alla base di questi giardini, di questi parchi, che un po' come diciamo fanno gli immigrati che si spostano da un paese all'altro. In questo parco, in questo giardino, andiamo a vedere delle realtà come degli alberi che non appartenevano a quel giardino, quindi sono delle entità diciamo in movimento, che si sono spostate, che hanno degli elementi che si sono spostati da una parte all'altra.
Okay. And what is interesting, obviously the temple in the English garden wasn't the real temple, it was interpretation. And in another scale, so the temple is in the same time English as it is Greek. And this is, I think, a bit similar like immigration. When you do migrate from one culture to the other, you remain, part of you remain your original culture. But a lot of you also changes into the new culture, becoming your new hybrid, becoming you, something new, a new kind of culture. So, and this this is something very rich. When you reach these kind of situations that can be very fruitful for developing of new ideas, is when we were talking today about changing your position, your perspective of seeing things. If you suddenly, instead of looking at things like an architect, you look at things like a doctor, that changes your perspective. And this is maybe interesting. Yeah.
Quindi, come un po' per quanto riguarda, ad esempio, il tempio, il
greco.
Tempio in, sorry,
greco.
Greco, sì, il tempio in England.
Yes.
Yes. Il tempio appunto in Inghilterra era un'interpretazione del tempio greco. Quindi, allo stesso modo, la stessa idea ci fa pensare agli immigrati che nello spostarsi da un paese all'altro, senza dubbio continueranno a mantenere una parte della loro origine di partenza, ma acquisiranno degli elementi della nuova cultura, diventeranno, diciamo, un nuovo ibrido culturale. E questo elemento è un elemento molto ricco, che può rivelarsi molto utile per sviluppare nuove idee. Noi, appunto, come architetti, dobbiamo cambiare, se ci mettiamo ad osservare un luogo dal punto di vista di un dottore, vedremo nuove prospettive, cambieremo la prospettiva di quello che stiamo vedendo.
So, in the end, there is always a kind of cyclical change. The way you think changes because you start to translate things. Translating makes you think about your original language as it makes you learn the new one. Okay? And it's not only a psychological change that happens with you, also a physical change. You know that your face, the muscles you use to speak a certain language are different. So people that constantly speak French, for example, get very beautiful, very thick lips because we Germans have like serious faces like me. No, or the Americans have these potato faces. So it doesn't matter if they're black or not. So in the end, you can see how you change. Not only your head changes, the way you think, because you have to rethink a lot of values that you have, but also physically you change. But one essential thing that has to do with the project, and I'm going on to present it to you, you have to be waiting long enough for that, but one thing that is essential, and this is maybe the last one, is that one thing that the migrant doesn't have and is not allowed to show is his objects, you know? When you grow in your city, if you're from Bari, you are surrounded by your Bari stuff since you are a child. You see the things developing. They are there all the time. When you go to another place, this kind of common things, or the everyday things, suddenly disappear. Okay? And the idea of this project is if it's possible to translate or to translate some of these objects of everyday life. Yeah? So instead of being these temples of Greece that we translate objects of everyday life from these different cultures. And to finish the concept is the last column of the project. In Denmark, the culture of participation is very strong. Very long developed since the 50s. They are working with participation. But the problem here is that they couldn't apply the idea of participation like they're used to because the people that live here do not speak Danish, many of them, and are also poor. They don't have the time to and the motivation to participate in this discussion process. So the idea was that we said, to start with, this space doesn't have any object that is Danish. Everything is foreign, from the plants, to the garbage bin, to the sewage cover, every object is foreign. But most of the objects are not just transported, but they are done in Denmark or in Germany. So there are bad copies that become, being in the same time, Danish as they are foreign. Yeah? And in the idea of participation, the idea was, instead of telling the people, oh, come and discuss with us, we said them, propose objects that you would like out of your culture to be placed in this space. The concept has to do with the fact, as an architect you know, as a designer you know, that the biggest fulfillment is to see your abstract idea built, done in reality. And participation, okay, another analogy, and that's the last one for today. When you are pregnant, I mean, I've never been pregnant actually, so I don't know exactly how it is, but that's how I imagine it, yeah? When you're pregnant, you have three moments, I would say, three essential moments. Two are fun, and one is rather painful. I've seen it. So the one that is fun or should be fun is sex. Yeah. Then you go It's not always fun, but most of the time. So this is that. Then you're pregnant, so you walk like, and you get bigger and bigger and bigger, and you can't walk anymore. And then you go to this butchery and get your child. You scream the hell out of you. It's incredibly painful, and it's a pain that we men have to join this experience. In other generations, we could stay outside, but now I have to share that. So, and then, but then everything is forgotten. The beautiful, cute baby. Oh, you know, all this pain, nothing happened. Mother happy, baby happy, everything okay. In participation, you know what we share with the people? We share pregnancy and we share the labor of giving birth. Instead of sharing with them sex and the joy of the baby. Okay? Participation is like, oh, let's discuss a little bit more. Yeah, a wonderful discussion. More discussion, yes. Okay. So is it none of that stuff? Why don't we share with the people what really is actually enjoy? We didn't have sex with the people, yeah? As far as I know. But we said let's share the joy of seeing things that you had in mind realized in real public space, and giving like that a kind of a pride of ownership to the space. And we acted more or less as curators of this object. You all understood. You don't need a translation for that, I think. Or anyone didn't understand? You all laughed. I tried to dance it. That might help. Okay, now go ahead. Or is it too long?
No, I can do it. Quindi, quando per esempio dobbiamo cambiare, dobbiamo spostarci da una lingua all'altra, abbiamo diciamo non soltanto un cambiamento, una cosa che avviene a livello del pensiero, quindi di passare da una lingua all'altra, ma anche a livello fisico abbiamo un movimento. Per esempio quando i francesi parlano hanno quella bocca diciamo carina, piccolina, oppure...
No, piccolina, grande. Sì. Big lips. I francesi.
French.
The French have big lips. Look.
Like that.
Yeah, okay.
Scusa.
Sorry.
No, I'm fine. Thank you. Quindi diciamo che la cosa importante è quella che appunto abbiamo nella mente delle cose che dobbiamo appunto realizzare nel... riusciamo a realizzare appunto in concreto, quindi sorry, I got lost. Per esempio appunto non è un po' come l'esempio che ha fatto, che cosa fa l'architetto? L'architetto cerca di vedere, deve riuscire a vedere, ad immaginare in astratto e a realizzare quella cosa che non c'è, la realizza appunto nella realtà, diciamo un po' appunto come ha fatto l'esempio della gravidanza, che ci sono tre momenti, due momenti di divertimento ed un momento in cui non, diciamo, di dolore. Quindi abbiamo il movimento di divertimento appunto del sesso, dovrebbe essere sempre così, la fase in cui la mamma si vede diventare sempre più grande, e poi il momento di dolore, il momento in cui appunto partorisce. Noi però che cosa succede? Che nel condividere con le persone, per quanto riguarda la partecipazione con gli altri, noi condividiamo soltanto le parti divertenti, la parte di gioia, la parte del momento appunto in cui vediamo realizzata quella cosa che fino ad allora avevamo soltanto in mente. Scusate per la traduzione, ma
no.
È che
si potrebbe, diciamo, fare in modo da riassumere dei concetti, oppure non so.
Il problema è che lui dice tantissime cose, quindi se io prendo appunti devo poi andare attraverso gli appunti.
Non so, fare abbiamo discusso un po' di riassumere un po' il senso delle cose, cioè, facciamo la traduzione parola per parola, però non sono così interrotta la questione.
Tu dici di chiedere se vuole che facciamo solo un riassunto?
Credo che sia. Maybe we can just make a
bisogno di una traduzione, io penso.
No, perché possiamo parlare.
Ok.
Voi avete bisogno di una traduzione?
Good.
They don't need a translation? Okay. Sorry, but you do a good job. I don't worry.
No, it's very hard.
I know. Okay, so in the end, projects are a little bit, this process of pregnancy, I think, or this moment of joy and of suffering are also typical for projects. The moment of creating projects is always this when creativity really turns you on, it's a little bit like sex, okay? So that's really joyful. But then getting this into reality is painful. You go to the construction site. In Spain, people drink on construction site. You have to stop them drinking, you know? And in other places, they don't do what you ask them, or they say, it's 5 o'clock, I go. And so it's a painful process. But afterwards, when the baby is there, when the project is done, everyone is happy. So, oh, look at this project, it was so nice, and so on. So in the end, it's similar. And I think that participation, if you want projects and people involvement, you have to try to involve them in joy and not in the pain, because no one is going to come. Maybe some perverts that like to be hit, you know, but no one else. So you need to develop these ideas out of joy instead of pain. The project it's in the north of Copenhagen. As I said, the place has like three spaces. It used to be super kiln, means super wedge. Maybe that you should a wedge. A wedge is, I don't know the Spanish word either.
Spanish.
Yeah. So, and it used to be a tram. Copenhagen used to have trams running through the city, and this is the tram, the house where the trams would sleep at night. Okay. So, and it was, before we came to work here, already a green space, but quite a leftover space, and this area was called the black market, yeah, because it's the most important drug selling area of Copenhagen. So this is part of the strategy to turn it black then, but I'm going to talk to you about that later. That was the perspective we prepared for the competition. That the competition is now, I would say, six years old. And as you see, there are all these objects from different places. The garbage bin from England, some advertisement objects, because one of the things that still remain kind of cultural related is advertisement objects, I think, because many things get globalized. But advertisement can be incredibly and radically different from culture to culture. And it's interesting when you travel to look at advertisement out of a point of view of the aesthetics and the cultural context. So in China, they're very different. Even from Italy or from Switzerland to Germany, they're completely radically different. Even we do speak the same language. So and so we thought that these objects can really, what the temple did in England, changing the scenery, giving you the sensation that you are in a different place. How do we create that today? And so I would say that the banality of objects of everyday create more atmosphere nowadays than this kind of special, almost religious objects like temples and bridges and all this stuff. And mainly advertisement. I think advertisement has an incredibly important influence on the space. To let you know where you are. Because the question is always, where am I? When you're constantly traveling. So if you do not understand, please interrupt me. Okay, I don't mind trying to explain it in a better way, okay? Or if I'm talking too strong. So this is, and then also, Copenhagen is a very gray city, so we said everything should be colorful, should show this kind of richness of differences of cultures that we have here, and not this kind of sobriety, this kind of seriousness of the city. So that's the reason we did this, the red square. Yeah, there you see the participation situation, yeah? And the interesting thing, for the first meetings you will see here, there were only the Danish people attending. That's when we started to rethink our concept of participation, because it wasn't there from the very beginning. And so these are the, I think we have 100 objects on site. Here you see them all placed on different areas. Another thing that has also to do with the transition between second and third dimensionality is the issue that we could use one side of one of the houses. My idea was, when I discuss sometimes collaboration with architects, and architects say, ah, we can do open spaces too, you know? And I say, yeah, we can do facades, yeah? Because, so where does it start? I said, the open space actually contains the facade. You can do the bathrooms, we do the facade and the square, you know? And so here we could realize it, so we did this, our first facade. And there is also a relationship. We had this red Acer, so in this red square, we had also this red Acer as the tree. And then we have the situation that objects that are very temporary, because advertisement is quite temporal, that suddenly in Superkiln they become perpetual. They get a longer life than they would get in real life. So they become this kind of thing like the Rocky statue. So people from America, if they want to see a donut sign, they might have to go to Copenhagen to see a real one. Okay, so these kind of things I like very much. This is the black square that we did black, and this is a little bit the psychological or psychoanalytical approach that I was talking about today to you, discussing your side, that is not about solving certain situations, but sometimes it's also framing them, giving them a name, you know? It's like a coming out kind of situation. Say, for me, there are difficulties in life. There are difficulties in cities. It's not about solving them all. It's about giving them maybe a slightly different perspective or frame them to work, to be more tolerable. And then maybe even being part of a new character that makes the place also desirable and interesting and gives it an identity. So out of the black market was the idea of the black square was born. So that instead of trying to get the drug people out, we kind of institutionalized this. Almost, you know, because the space can't really change the social situations in the end, you know. It can't just give a hint or can try to frame it in a new way, okay? So, but the strategy is instead, we are used to try to solve situation, like a problem has to be solved, okay? And I think this is in general, very often the wrong strategy, and it's better to avoid trying to solve instead of trying to use the problem and making out of the problem something interesting. This is a telephone booth from Brazil. So, and this is one of the first objects that were proposed by the people. There was this immigrant guy from Muscat who said, I have this uncle of mine, he paid me to come to Denmark, he gave me the money, I'm very proud of him, and I would like if we could put this sign on the square, yeah? What we obviously immediately did, yeah, but you can see this one is like foreign, yeah, and this one is really beautiful Nordic design, you know. So, and this one probably already disappeared, and this one will be there for 1,000 years, not 1,000, not, but a long time. So, in the end, this is what I was talking about. The, let's say the, symbolism. Kind of survives, and the form somehow also survives, but it becomes also completely something else as well. So it has this kind of two things. It's foreign and it's Danish in the same time. And that's what happens, I think, when you migrate, that you are in the same time, symbolically somehow also foreign, but in the end you are also, you become on some point part of the society, obviously, that is the majority society in which you live. Yeah. So, and as I said, most of the objects were done. We had to draw them, we had pictures most of the time, and we redraw them and made construction drawings to get them done then later on site. Yeah. So, and the interesting thing as well for this project is, normally when we do design, we like to be like dictators. You know, we like to say everything has to be in that direction, everything has to be pink, everything has to be like that, you know. And I think if you want to do projects like that, you need tasteful and educated dictators, okay? But there aren't many left of those guys. I mean, educated dictators, I don't know if they ever existed, yeah? But, well, Adolf Hitler was one of them, but he was not very successful. So, in the end, these kind of people are not the clients we are having to deal with. Most of the time, we have to somehow develop ideas, permissive ideas. But permissive ideas have the tendency to create banality and mediocrity. So how can we use permissive ideas without losing aesthetic quality? And so in that case, the mix of things actually, I think, worked very well. So there was also a group of people that wanted to save the birds. And they said, what happens with all the birds? We need places for the birds to nest. So we did these boxes for the birds to nest. So you can, if you do a project that is so open, you can start adding stuff because it never, and even changing, because it actually never stops to be continuously developed. Yeah. So this is the original sign from America. This is then the drawings. And like in the English park, you have this kind of superimposed realities where you don't know what is really advertisement and what is not really advertisement. So what can I buy and what is just faking? And this idea is also very common to us, that we don't know exactly what is real, what is not, where is someone trying to sell me something and when not. I think this is very typical for our internet thing. So I like this kind of tilting of realities, and I think this is a little bit similar to the concept of the English landscape part. Or this guy, that being an advertisement became the sign of Spain as a vacation destination. If the Germans don't see the bull on the mountain, it's not Spain. So what did Spain, being quite pragmatic, they took the bull as part of their landscape cultural heritage. The brandy that used to be advertised by this bull doesn't exist anymore. So the bull as an advertisement sign survived, actually the product it was advertisement, becoming a sign of identity for a whole region. It, landscape-wise and construction-wise, completely disgusting, by the way. So the only nice thing in the end is probably this bull that survived. So it's an object that was meant as an image for a product becomes independent of that and something else. So that's the reason we took it into, and it was everywhere in the press in Spain actually when we put it here. So different advertisement signs that are actually, because you don't know what they say, they become interesting just to look at them. Yeah, and this is what you see is a clear reality of the site. So who belongs? Where are we? I mean, if you are very intelligent, you can see, well, the brick colors seem Nordic, but I mean, this guy looks quite drunk. It's 11 in the morning, has beer in the back, so he's Danish. Here you see the future of the country. The Danish people have the biggest pram. Like, we Germans have the biggest cars, Mercedes. They have the biggest prams, you know? They have huge prams, yeah, like tanks, yeah? And they put one little Danish baby in it. This woman has 4 kids in that one, you know? So this is the future of the country. The Danish have 1, she has 4, you know, same pram. Very practical, yeah? So that's what I mean. These pollards come from Ghana. Well, I also like the process of doing that, because I said that I like cultivation, but it's not true. I like instantaneity. Because I'm a landscape architect, I wish to have things that look good right away, because I don't want to wait 100 years till they look nice. So painting, obviously, has this kind of immediacy of creating atmospheres. But in that case, it has also to do with the fact that this place couldn't wait. You know, this place needed a chemotherapy in that respect. This place was in need of immediate development, because it was deprived of identity, of qualities, etc. So you couldn't say, I do something and I wait 20 years till the trees are big and then it's okay. That would work if it's a bourgeois neighborhood where they don't mind, you know, that's okay. But for this neighborhood, we needed an immediate kick in the ass that would be really, really visible. So that's the reason we use these colors here. That was the opening of the site. Yeah, that's not important. You see, the population starts to adjust to our color concept, which is quite nice. These swings are from Iraq. And this is from Ukraine. That was a woman from Ukraine proposing this elephant that was around the corner where she lived, and she if we could do it. So this is Ukraine, this is Denmark, yeah? So, well, obviously we also have an app, a Superkiln app, that you can download if you like, that you can actually picture the objects and then you get the story of the objects. Because one thing that I forgot to say, some of the objects some of the participation concept was in 5 objects. In the case of 5 objects, we went with the people to the place where they originally were from to take the objects back to the site or to look for the objects. Okay, so this is kind of the whole, because a place needs always a myth. Okay, like a state needs a myth. Like you have the Roman Empire and we have the Second World War, you know? You need a starting point from which you have an imaginary. So the imaginary of this project is very, very important. So the pre-information of this project, so the participation became kind of everyone talks about it. Because obviously in the neighborhood, if someone comes knocking on your door and says, do you want to go to Lebanon or do you want to go to America to get an object or to Thailand? Wouldn't that be fun? It's more fun than going to a discussion about the public space, blah, 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 for 3 hours, okay? So And so this is part of the story of some of the objects that you can then read with the app. So if you want information, you can have information, but if you are not interested, you don't need to have it. So this is also part of the second life of this project, that it can be enjoyed in a very banal way. It's playful, it's full of infrastructure, you can do a lot of things there. But also, if you like to, it can have the second life. And some people are also only going to maybe some of you never going to visit it, so you only get the second life of it somehow. But the second life for the image of the place is almost as important nowadays as the real image is anyway, especially if it comes to identity. So these are the different nationalities. As I said, also the sewage covers are foreign, so there is no object that is Danish. This in that case, it's the sister cities of Copenhagen. So that was the story of this wall that we could make part of the square. The Muscle Beach. This object I like. This is a group of Jamaicans that live in the area. And they proposed to have these boxes. In Jamaica, they have these boxes on the street many times. And in that case, you can download with a Superkinen app, you can play your music with your telephone. Okay, so the noise is regulated, obviously, and it doesn't work at night. But they can turn it on if there's a concert. They can use it for it. So this kind of privatizing and influencing the public space with your own music is kind of part of the concept, and also rethinking the elements that would happen on these kind of spaces. This bench is from Switzerland. This object I like very much as well. This box ring. It is a Thai community there on site. Everyone is a racist. We all know. It doesn't matter if you're black, green, or whatever. Everyone is a racist. Everyone is scared that you don't marry into the next village, because they are all dangerous people, okay? You stay here in the village because it's better, we don't know all of them, etc. So we know that story that we are scared of differences. And we are always surprised that people that might be look different, live a different life, are nice nevertheless. It's always a surprise. So it's about being able to show that you are nice too. So these guys that were these youngsters, they used to have a space where they would train boxing. And so you would walk by, and you would hear all these, and you would say, oh, these foreigners are killing another again, That would be like the typical racist reaction. But if this killing another happens in public, it becomes fun. It's like football or any other sport. So aggression that seems to be something dangerous suddenly becomes an attraction. Because as we love to see other people working, we love also see other people kicking their ass off. Yeah? So, so these kind of things, how something that seems dangerous in public becomes interesting. And then we had this box. You see these two Danish ladies trying to get more. He does it better. So these kind of things normally used to happen in the neighborhood a lot, because there is a lot of aggression. There is a lot of problems. But in the end, well, the idea was to use them as part of the project and to make the project through these things more interesting. Here you see the guys kicking and the blonde girls watching. It's a West Side Story, Western girls and East Side boys. Yeah. There's only blonde girls, you see, and black guys. So they're still selling their drugs. So these are some pictures from above now. This was all the red square. Now we come into the black square. Yeah. This is by night. Okay. So this is from above. Here you see the project. So part of this communication communication process was as well that we hired a very, very expensive photographer that said, I only take photographs if I can rent a helicopter. So we said, okay, go ahead. And so these beautiful pictures came along then. And it shows actually how, in the end, how homogeneous the city actually is, and how resistant it is actually to changes, and how strong actually this this bit of colorfulness in this area starts. And the process is that actually, because it's so interesting and because it has so much infrastructure, the children ask their parents, we want to go there because they have boxing. And we want to go there, they have this very special slide. So people from all around the city start to go to a neighborhood that used to be just for people that, that would live there and even being seen as dangerous, you know. And suddenly, there is a process of making this place interesting. Nevertheless, because the elements we use, the materials we use, are kind of cheap. They're not really cheap, but they look cheap, yeah. And they also don't old, they don't have patina kind of aging, but they quite look already quite harsh. That makes it also that it doesn't become this kind of too classical space where maybe gentrification and in the end what happened. So we played with the issue to keep the place, to keep a certain tension, not to just produce the opposite of what you wanted, that just people, rich people would move in the neighborhood because it's fun. So to keep the loud music on the boxes, you know, certain things that rich people just don't like, you know, or too much boxing is also maybe on the weekend, but you don't want to have it every day, you know. So these kind of things also help to keep the tension of the neighborhood without turning it, without gentrifying it. Yeah? So this is the black square, and the black square formally plays with the issue that the second dimension grows into a third dimension, that this topography on the green park. This is an object from Japan. These are palm trees from China. This is from Morocco. Here there is a parrilla from Argentina, up grill. That was my proposal. Very popular. But it plays formally with the issue that what we see and what we feel can be different. So the issue that when you see lines like that, that it seems like topographical, but it's actually not. So faking as a strategy of landscape architecture. So what is the real mountain and what not? So this is just formally. And the trees are cherry trees and palms and cedars in that area. So and then we have these tables that actually people used to sit down, but they also do because they have quite small apartments. And these people from these different cultures have in many times also big families. So when they have a big festivity, they do it outside. So they don't mind to use the open space in a more private way, because I used to do that from their cultures. They don't have this kind of restrictions, so the place is really very lively. This looks like Gran Canaria, I think. I don't know why, but I mean, palm trees, that's thanks to global warming, that we can have palm trees in Copenhagen. Beautiful lady. So this is this object from Japan. In Japan, this object, this octopus, is kind of the most average playground object ever. Okay, that happens in every corner in Japan. But translated somewhere else, it becomes something else. And so we actually transported it, but we had the Japanese firm who sold it to us sending the Japanese people to construct and to overlook the construction site. And because it's on the black square, we did it black. And also in that case, the population starts to adjust to our color concept in that area. This is from Argentina, the grill. So actually, in the end, it's also offering objects and things to do that you wouldn't have in other spaces. There's no grills in other spaces. They use it. They love it. I mean, look at, they love it. They love it. They do a whole lamb on it, you know. That's they love it. And it's actually this kind of, to a certain extent, privatizing, because when you see, because racism has also to do with paranoia. If you see people doing things, even if they're a bit strange, you feel more kind of, okay, they're cooking. I mean, they are eating. It smells good, you know. It's kind of, suddenly you see that they are also human beings and you don't need to be scared of them maybe as much as you are. So, this is from Venezuela. This must be, this is like, the most special thing is the back of this guy. It's a landscape of its own. The front as well. But it, you know, this, yeah, it's really, he needs a, depilation. So it's about there is potential aggression in this kind of neighborhoods. So how to deal with it? How to canalize it? How to make it part of the park without being making it something dangerous but fun? And how to get these people to get rid of their extra energy, so to speak? This is from Russia. This is from Uzbekistan. There's another grill area, by the way. These are also barbecues. These guys here, smaller ones, with the sitting area. Because, you know, in the end, it's also like that. The more poor the people, the more need they have for public space. Because if you have money, you go somewhere in the countryside, or you have a weekend house even with a barbecue. So it's actually, or you have a big apartment and you don't like to go out anyway. So it's actually for the public space. Is a way to, it's an offer from the society also to the deprived classes, I think, and also to help them to change and to find a way to upper classes, so to show interest in what they, in their needs, actually. So, because rich people in the end don't need it as much. These are two guys from Latin America drinking in front of the bull. This is one of my favorite objects that you almost don't see. It's earth from Palestina. And there are a lot of Palestinians living in Copenhagen, refugees, most of them. And these people ask to if they could bring, because they have all this idea of belonging, and we know that belonging has a lot to do with the earth, yeah, and the country, so to speak. And so you almost don't see it, actually. So if you don't know the story and you don't have the app, it's actually almost invisible. But for the people, for the community, actually, they meet there. And they, you know, it's kind of their object kind of thing. So all these different objects. The sewage cover from Israel is not far from here, by the way. So in the end, also, we imported partly as well the conflicts. This is a bus stop from, I forgot, it's Uzbekistan, somewhere, one of the Stan republics out of the Soviet Union. And we loved it because it has these Islamic typologies in the construction. So we actually put it here as well, and we also put a bus sign here. But there is no bus stopping on this bus stop. So this tells also a little bit about the story that public space needs to, especially, you know, it's always contextual. So in our Nordic societies, where everything has so much order and everything has to work and everyone has to function, humor and kind of dislocating and changing the reality of things can be incredibly relaxing. And I think that's important, that open spaces in that context especially create this kind of surrealism where the things are not meant to be used the way they are meant to be used, but they become something else. It's a little bit like in Alice in Wonderland. It's also one of my favorite objects. And here you see a typical Danish situation. The Danish girl, it's probably above 15 degrees, is already half naked. The Islamic terrorist, but Danish, because on a bicycle, with children's seat, security is very important. So you see already the transformations that happened in the neighborhood. And as last picture, and part of this communication skills and a little bit of advertisement too, is there is a book now being on sale about the Superkilling project that got a project of itself and part of this kind of second life. This project is also very famous because it has been published maybe almost too much. It got a lot of attention because I think because it's very beautiful and because it has a very good concept and very objective. But what is interesting, to a certain extent, also it became almost independent of because we tried to manipulate a lot of things, but obviously we couldn't manipulate the whole procedure. One of them that I'm very proud of, the project is in the official site of Denmark, for example, as a representative project of the country, and obviously the one in Copenhagen. So if you visit Copenhagen, you see the mermaid. You know this. Virgin on the rock, that is kind of the Danish thing, and you see this project as the kind of typical thing. And then there is this book that I think, because there's a lot of information in this project, and it's interesting to read about it, so maybe you like to buy it. Thank you very much. It got a bit too long, huh?
Ok. È
acceso? Sì, è acceso.
Forse diciamo è stata un po' una presentazione, una lezione abbastanza tormentata, molto divertente. E, se qualcosa non è chiaro, qualcuno vuol fare delle domande, vuol chiedere qualcosa.
The thing that I didn't understand so well is why, for example, in this project you were talking that the things that I didn't understand in this project is a matter of approach. You provide like barbecue and this kind of things for people, as you were saying, because the lower classes of the society sometimes they doesn't have the devices or the way to enjoy their own life. But I, in my opinion, it's a little bit a pity, or maybe there is another reason behind, I don't know, why you choose to explain the history and to collect all the memories, an application that runs on a mobile phone. And when you didn't develop a kind of small wayfinder system, I don't know, some short text to explain, maybe also to collect and to fix in the place the memory of the people, because maybe it's a pity if I don't have a device, a smartphone, how can I appreciate all the history about the Palestinian soil and the...
Well, that's like always in life, you know? I mean, if you're interested, you have to fight a little bit for information, I would say. And we have an overkill information amount about everything nowadays, you know? So I think that it has to be a second quality, because the space has to be just a fun and interesting space to be. I don't want to bother the people and to have the say, oh, I have to think about the Palestinian soil. So it's a choice, I think, you know. It's not a museum or a remembrance space. It's an everyday space to be enjoyed. As it is an interesting academic discussion for architects, as it is important identity things for the foreigners in this space, etc., etc. So it has a lot of layers. And I think that they all have to be careful with another somehow. But the main layer for me, nevertheless, is there has to be a very beautiful and useful space for everyday people living there. You know, so it shouldn't be kind of forcing. We discuss these issues, actually, obviously. And in the end, we said that, and there are names, by the way, and the origin country is always on this. There's a little sign with the name of the object, bench, and then it says Venezuela or Brazil or whatever, where they come from. So there is a small amount of information. If you want more, you can. And you see a lot of people with this, and these devices everyone has. But they're also not interesting. Again, one has to be careful, because it might seem almost educative otherwise too. I don't like that when places want to be educative. They're educative for you as a strategy, but they shouldn't be educative to the people. Then it's stupid. Then it's kind of, you know, that shouldn't be. I don't think that works. It produced the opposite. It produced rather rejection, I would say.
Yeah. Actually, I have many questions, but I just...
No, go ahead, yeah.
Yeah, just make one a little bit technical.
Okay, ask me.
Here in Italy, maybe in other part of Europe, when you want to deal with a public space, you have to kind of transform your original idea, because then you have to know that if you do this, maybe children can hurt themselves. Mm-hmm. They have to follow the ISO, I don't know. And then maybe you want to do something really funny, and then if you want to fit to the law, everything transforms so much that the original idea is not anymore what is really built. And I don't know if you here had this kind of problems, because...
Of course. But
you were able to manage with these things without transforming so much the original object?
Well, partly we had two things. One, as we talked about subversism or terrorism today at some point. So we took risks, and we have some lawsuits with the city, so we have problems. So we took the risks, and we said it's worth taking the risks for a project like that, and it's a bit of a pain in the ass to have to fight. But for example, The park has been incredibly successful, as on an everyday way, so that the objects partly also break, But because they are machines, they break. It's like when you have a car, even if it's a German car, if you drive it too long, it breaks. So, and as the park has been so incredibly successful and so overused in the end, some of the objects break. But the city is trying to tell us that we didn't do a right job, you know, and that we should, I don't know, pay for it. Yeah. So we are on this kind of process. So this kind of risk taking, you have to a certain extent, also play your own safety and you have to be, I always say experimenting can blow up with the object. I mean, if you're a chemist and you do experiments, you can blow up with a thing, trying to discover something. And as an architect, that can happen too. And if you are really devoted to the cause, then you should, not in all projects, but in certain projects, also overcome your own fear. Because my impression is that most of the colleagues put the state laws just as a pretext. And they're too scared to do anything interesting. So, but that's, you should just say fuck them and go for it. If you feel safe, if you believe that what you do is right, if you're not so sure, then leave it, of course. But I think that you have, every profession has to take some risks. There's no profession without risks, you know. So a doctor takes risks when he operates and also to find new ways of doing things, you have to be able also to fail. I mean, every profession has failures and learns out of failures. There is no, so this is that. On the other side, we had a very good advisors to help us with the security issues. So we had guys writing on us security, saying, going over the objects with us. I mean, also the stuff that you can buy that has the security things have been done. We had good money, I must say, too. It was very well paid. I mean, that wasn't a problem. It wasn't that we had to like fight for every penny. And they wanted the project. They believed in the project. We didn't have to fight for the project. You know, in the end, they were quite convinced it was a very good idea. So it's both. So you need also to a certain extent a convinced client. I mean, if you have to work all the time against the client, then that's not going to work. I mean, even if it's not all about security, you need somehow to, that's a good thing if you do competitions and these kind of things that you have then a decision taken for a project, then you can do it.
I have a question. Is a Superkillen a site-specific project, or it could be also a global concept that can we export all over the world?
Well, it is site-specific as a project, but obviously strategically something that you can transport to other places. But as a project, as a design project, obviously it's site-specific. But as a concept, I think you could, as I said, the concept is also not new. The concept in the end is the concept of the English landscape garden of Romanticism. It's not just for architects might be new, but for us landscape architects, something that exists for a long time, that is the idea of transporting to think of different spaces. You know, gardens always been about transporting things. In the orangerie, you know, the French king wanted to have oranges in February in Paris, you know, so it's also a way of, because it's part of a tradition updated in the end. So instead of the oranges and the temple, we have advertisement and switch covers. Okay, so we say most of the people come from very colorful cultures, okay, from the Caribbean. So color is an issue. So we bring it in. So in the end, we applied and we combined old traditional strategies with new needs and the social context of collaboration, of participation, that we in the end used almost like an accident. You know, when we deal as landscape architects with nature, we can't calculate everything. I mean, you as architects can detail everything and things. I mean, if you don't build in Italy, they turn up the way you draw them. Yeah, but we as landscape architects, we have trees. We don't know where they're going to grow. If they're going to die, or you don't know. One might be faster. You can predict. You can obviously predict some of it, but not all of it. So there's always these accidental situations. You can't predict the weather, so there's always changes. And so for me, the participation was almost this natural element that you can't predict. For example, I think that the Moroccan fountain I wouldn't have liked to have, okay? But it's great to have it, but I wouldn't be able to accept it as my proposal, even if I actually kind of like it. So this is kind of this accident that then sneak into the project. And this is for me what I call permissive, that you can create a structure that allows a lot of things to happen without losing its aesthetic value. Actually, the opposite, gaining its aesthetic value out of the richness of these accidents. Okay, and this I would say is quite unique, or unique for our time, because for now, especially in Germany, landscape architecture has to be quite minimalistic. Okay, so it's not about this kind of obscenity of objects that's being seen as something like backwards, or it's kitsch if it's like that, you know. So we found a way to update this this kitsch and fight against the stupid minimalism.
Like an open source.
Sorry?
Like an open source.
A little bit like
project.
An open source, so it plays with, and I think one thing we didn't mention, but was very important, was also the collaboration with the other two offices that was very competitive. And so it wasn't kind of a harmonic collaboration, but quite, quite fighty. But it was good because it made everyone kind of who has the best idea, you know, who goes further. So it extremized everyone a little bit. What was good for this project, I think so. Because I think that's another issue, that nowadays it's not the genius, the guy that does the drawing on the Soviet, but it's about groups working together and also finding different collaborations for different tasks. That because no one can do these things nowadays alone. So, and in science, it's for a long time like that. Architects, to a certain extent, stay a little bit autistic in that respect, I would say.
Alcune domande?
Anche in italiano, eh?
Anche in italiano. Of course. You're very welcome.
Yeah, that's. I would like to know, after 2 years, you say it's 2 years old.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes when you do a participation process, sometimes you try to make the people work with the construction of the site, because so they have a kind of belonging of the place. So they take care of it, they try to save, to
yeah.
guard it,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
as you said at the beginning. But do you think that also this project is working in this way, that the people are proud of the space and it's trying to defend and to avoid, I don't know, people that destroy for fun things?
I think so. I mean, because the objects belong to them.
Yeah.
And they speak also not only for the people who propose them, but slightly also for certain communities that are there. So, and they know that they can be very aggressive. They're more efficient than the police. You know, so if you go and do something on the Moroccan fountain, next day you hang somewhere on a tree. So that works very well, I would say. But what happens is nevertheless that there is destruction, but mainly with the play objects. I mean, obviously a swing developed by a German engineer would survive longer than these stupid Iraqi swings that we proposed there. So we have a lot of trouble with these things. And what also happened is obviously the colors aren't as shiny anymore. They also old, and they get older faster than if it would be granite or something nice. So, but for me also that is part of the project, that it is not about being beauty in a traditional way, but about allowing a certain amount of dirtiness and punkness, so to speak, into the.
It happened here, for example, in a square that they built. It's a very interesting square. They, I don't know if you see that there are some benches that rotate only on and. They let them, these benches rotate just the first day, just for the inauguration, and then they fixed them to the ground floor. So they killed the concept of the square, but because they want to preserve the image of the square. So sometime to avoid this kind of misuse of the public space, and sometime you have to deal with people that use it. So this is
I mean, you have to be able to be a little bit more relaxed about things in the end, you know? I mean, in the end, so much control in the end. But obviously it's different from culture to culture, from country to country. I mean, you can't generalize these things. And again, I think the problems you have probably in Bari are very different to those in Copenhagen, nevertheless, you know? So it's different issues. So I don't think that you can, but what I do think, there are certain areas, I mean, this is probably the most socially the most deprived area of Copenhagen. So it was really needed, you know. I mean, that was the reason as we discussed the idea of the market. I mean, it can be a nice project, but who cares? I mean, it's not so essential. I mean, you should have more problems than just that, I imagine. If not, you should just do something else. You know what I mean? I'm not completely serious, but but it's not a really maybe not the project that needs this kind of experimental approach. Let's put it like that, because this experimental approach you only can apply to very 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 dead patients. You know, if you want to try a new treatment, who do you do it with? With a patient that is hopeless, you know? You go and say, I have a new chemotherapy, let me try it. You're not going to try it on a space that is kind of, on a 30-year-old that has headache. You're going to go for the 80-year-old grandma that is completely fucked, and then you might try it. And if she survives, everyone is happy, but if she dies, it's also not such a big thing, okay? So with the city, it's similar. If you want to go that far as we did here, you need also the context for it. It's not something that you can, I think context is completely essential.
It's called that we want to do a prevention approach instead of intervention.
Yeah, for example. That would be probably better. The prevention approach would be to prevent this place to be developed would be probably more intelligent in the end, for example. But I just wanted to say about the experimentation, because obviously many things we did here, we did them also for the first time. And some of them actually also didn't work really the way we thought. And that you can do in a space like that, in an area like that, where also there are not all these picky neighbors, you know, this house-deprived housewife that come and ring the mayor and say, ah, the bench is broken, you know. And they moved it again, you know. But you have all these people that have better things to do than being like, So in the end, again, I think that the context of projects, the intelligence, I think, of planning nowadays has to do with seeing what possibilities and what needs different spaces would. And being able to develop for all these different necessities, different strategies. Because all our predecessors as planners and architects just had mostly one strategy for the whole life. You know, they did squares everywhere, or they did everywhere, I don't know. They did something everywhere, doesn't matter where. And that was this kind of international style that destroyed many, many places, I think, and it was actually not site-specific, but just applied everywhere the same. And that kills spaces, or let's say, till these spaces get to be part of a normal city situation is going to take 300 years. Till one house falls down and they build a new house, you know, and then they start to come alive and part of the flow, of the cultivation of the city, it's going to take ages. And this is the problematic, I would say.
Io ringrazio Martin Rencano e approfitto un attimo per raccontarvi quello che stiamo facendo nel corso di questo laboratorio. Noi abbiamo cominciato ieri con José Luis Vallejo dello studio spagnolo Ecosistema Urbano a provare a costruire delle strategie per il riuso della manifattura tabacchi. Stiamo lavorando, diciamo, da ieri per produrre un tweet, l'abbiamo chiamato, quindi un'idea, una proposta, uno spunto, una suggestione per il riuso di questo luogo, e domani mattina avremo un momento conclusivo in cui ci confronteremo su appunto questi che sono i tweet, le suggestioni che sono venute, che verranno fuori. Ora noi continueremo a lavorare con i gruppi che hanno iniziato questa attività e se, come dire, vi va, siete curiosi di vedere i risultati, l'appuntamento è per domani mattina alle 10 con Martin Rencano e saranno con noi Guglielmo Minervini, assessore alle politiche giovanili della Regione Puglia, e Angela Barbanente, assessore alla qualità del territorio, sempre di Regione Puglia. E domani, diciamo, si concluderà questo percorso di questo laboratorio, che questa qui è l'ultima sessione di una serie di appuntamenti, quindi il laboratorio che è cominciato un mese fa sul tema del riuso, laboratorio promosso da una serie di associazioni che si occupano dei temi della rigenerazione urbana, ossia Xscape, Garden Faber, Pop Up, app con siamo tutti tufi, vuoti a rendere, underground, esperimenti architettonici e in culture. E, niente, io vi ringrazio per la partecipazione, diciamo, vi chiediamo scusa se magari non è stato tutto perfetto, qualcuno è rimasto in piedi, cose di questo tipo, però appunto Laboratori dal Basso, ci auto-organizziamo e proviamo a fare il nostro meglio. Grazie a tutti. Grazie.